Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Leonard Cornelis.
I'm Leonard Cornelis. I'm a big data engineer at ING Bank in the Netherlands. So that's it, and IT is my hobby and my work. It's about containerization of data science models and how to get this smooth and seamless into production. Okay, welcome everybody. Welcome to my presentation about the Docker data science pipeline. I'm working for the ING Bank in the Netherlands, and we have a lot of data science models running. Trying to predict account forecasting from our customers and that kind of stuff, and we were having a lot of problems to run this smooth in production, and that gives us a lot of work. And finally we give ourselves an interest in Docker and containerization, and see how that can help us at ING. Let's introduce myself. Now, my name is Leonard Cornelis. I'm a big data engineer at ING. Main things I did before: DB2, Oracle, work with AEX, Linux. You name it, any system what exists in all those years, I touch it, even mainframe. And I think the last 4 or 5 years, I'm specializing on the Hadoop platform. So I know a lot about Hive, Scoop. We use Ansible to deploy stuff, and my main goal is to let everything work and make everybody happy. I worked before on an exploration environment with around 20 data scientists. And at the moment, I'm working on the production environment. So all the stuff that what those data scientists built, we are running now in the production. My name is Chiefware. That's a nickname. So you can find me on Docker Hub and on Twitter, or also have a blog nowadays. So just type Chiefware in Google and you will find me. Okay. Why I think you are here? Maybe I'm wrong, but I think a lot of people are running data science models, and you are also interested in Docker. And the biggest problem is maybe you're asking yourself, I built something nice, how do I get this into production? So maybe we can answer that today. So that is okay. What is Docker? How many people are already busy here with Docker? Ah, good. So I don't even have to explain what Docker is to you guys. But in fact, it is Docker can really help you to put all your tools in one place, instead of installing it on a virtual machine or even on a brick. You can just put it in a container and install everything there, and it is just really all together in one image. And even if you build something nice, you can even pick up that image and just send it to your colleague, and he just built up the same image, and he get exact the same software, and the stuff you made is exactly the same. So there's nothing changed there. So that is really a benefit. There's a way a lot of more benefits on Docker, using Docker, but I think as a data scientist, you just want to have that kind of stuff available for you. Let me tell you something about the way of working at ING. We adopt the Spotify model, and we work in a tribe. And on the vertical bar you see the squads. So I'm also a member of a squad. And what you have in your squad, you are just working on one product for the clients. And in your squad, you don't have much freedom to look at new stuff. When you want to just do some tests with some new version of a software, or you want to just investigate what can Docker mean for me, in your squad there is no space for that. So yeah, and for that we create chapters, and what is in the chapter is just several members from different squads. And in your chapter, you have just once or twice a month, you have just some freedom, some days that you can work together and just start busy on something new. And if you finally, sometimes you just are playing around and you don't find nothing, but sometimes you really find something cool. And then you say, okay, what we found here, we have to do something with it, and just bring it to the squad later on. And yeah, if there's time there, the squads, it can even be not even for your own squad, but it can also be for another squad. But yeah, and to me, it really feels. Before we always were busy, always doing the same stuff. But yeah, this really helps us, and I really like working in this agile way. Yeah, let's talk a little bit about the work from a data scientist at ING. What you see here, this is just an example of a prototype environment, and there on the left you see a development server, or sometimes they call it an edge node. But what is happening there? All the data scientists are logging on to the machine. They are installing stuff, and from there they just start their jobs and run their models, and they access then the data on the Hadoop cluster, and all the stuff what they built, they just put it in GitLab and just use Artifactory. And what you also see is a line around it. That is a big firewall. And because there's a lot of transaction data from clients inside this Hadoop environment, so you can only access it if you have to write writes to get there. But what we find out is that all those data scientists working on the same dev server, it gave us a lot of problem. In the end, we get performance problems. We get not wanted behavior of software because we were installing stuff next to each other, so it gives us a lot of problem. So we needed something to do with that, and also the stuff what they built, on the left on the prototype environment. That is just finally we need it into production. But what you get there is you have your prototype stuff, and there's a lot of work inside done by data scientists just for the environment where he was working on. And sometimes it gives a lot of errors, and what you get then, you end up in test, and you run it and it will fail. You have to go back to prototyping, and on. So, and before you end up in production, it can be really a long way for a data scientist to get there. And even more worse, the production environment at ING, because it's account information from clients. You don't want everybody to access it. So it is just like a fortress, a castle, and it is really difficult to get there. So what you get then is just whole teams, whole squads are busy to work on this case, to help data scientists models get into production. So if you look at my squad only, it's just 8 people was there busy all day engineering on what the data scientists built and trying to bring it to production. So that was just the case there. So we really needed something. Okay, go on back. So then we start investigating what can we do with the containerization, and how can that help us. Yeah. So what you see then is It's the same dev server where a data scientist is working on, but we start using OpenShift. I don't know if everybody knows what OpenShift is, but it is, yeah, to me it is just an UI on top of Kubernetes, and that is an orchestrator tool on top of Docker. And yeah, what we did is just let the data scientist build this stuff, and what he built, let's see what we have to do to put it in a container. So it is just the same situation. We just he was building stuff on the dev server, and finally he is finished, and then we just pick it up what he did, and put it in a Docker container. So, and on in the middle you see also a dev client that is even outside that firewall, and even there you have now the possibility to build that container. So you don't even have to be anymore in that difficult firewall security cluster. You can also be just on your laptop and just work on your laptop, that is just your dev client, and build your container there. And when you're finished, push it back to GitLab, and finally it will start running automatically. I will show you later in the demo how that works, but this was really a good progression for us. this is a little bit difficult picture. This is just, in fact, telling what is all the data science work all about. So here on the left you see just a development environment. On the top there's where the data gets from. That's just a Netezza environment, just an old this is an RDMS database. We have Hive there. We have the Git repositories and the data science code. When the data scientist builds something, then it have to be already some kind of production ready. So what we did is we built we call it a cookie cutter, but what we did is just pick the data science project and run a set of tests. We built that in Ansible, and we run a set of tests, and it's just checking inside the data science project what are all the variables there, and see if it is ready to go to production. So if you have it like that there, and it is just according to those, what is in the cookie cutter, then you are almost 99% sure that it also will run in production. So everything is in variable. So what we saw before, always the data scientist was building something, and then he put some database names from the prototype environment inside his project. So that kind of checks are we doing, so that we don't end up with different names, because in the production name everything have a different name. Yeah. Now on the big picture, that's just a picture how what all kind of stuff we are running to get all this Docker stuff running. On the top there's also a monitor dashboard that is used by data scientists to look at the performance from their project. You think that I make a mistake because I use an H in the monitor, but it's like this. It's from Tor. So just it's a joke of one of the data scientists. But I'll show you later how that is working. What you see on the right, there's the Docker registry. There's all the images what we are building that is available. And from there you can just build the images. Okay. let me tell you something about Docker files. Docker file is very easy to build. So sometimes you at the moment we don't even let data scientists build it, because we do it automatic. But if he really needs something special and he needs his own whatever Python installation or whatever, it is really easy for him to do it. He don't really have to learn something new, because what you see is just on the left. You see from is just where the image is coming from. Then you just run some commands, you copy some files what you need, and in the end of it, you have just a command what is executing. In this case, this is executing nothing, but it's just give just an example. What you also see is that there are some configuration files here, but later on we already take all these configuration files outside the container and have them already available on OpenShift. So what you get then is you have your image. Inside your image there is no any configuration or whatever available. That is all outside. So what you have done is your exploration environment. You have this set of configuration files that points to the right environment, to the right data. And yeah, so on, also to the test acceptance and production environment. They have their own set. Okay. Yeah, something about GitLab. Yeah, if you build something and you want to store it, so now everybody use GitLab. So and what you can build in GitLab, or what you can use, is just just webhooks. And for this case, I use GitLab Runner, but you can also do it with Jenkins. But what is happening at the moment? You commit something to GitLab Runner, then somewhere that can be in OpenShift or on another server, the GitLab Runner starts doing his work. And what is the GitLab Runner helping you with? He's just building the images, what is used for this to run his model. And at the end, he will send a signal to the OpenShift environment to start the model. So for that, we use GitLab Runner. Yeah, here you see some kind of pipeline in the GitLab Runner. So you see here, there is the build the image, and then you will tag the image, and later on you push it back to the repository. Then you delete some delete some files to get some space, and in the end you will start the job. So that is, and yeah, on the left there is an example of a GitLab CI file. And yeah, it's also easy to make. Okay. When we just started, we wanted to use, of course, Spark, and because that is the most used software that we have, Spark, to run our jobs on the Hadoop cluster. And yeah, when the first time I start using Spark from inside a Docker container, I really didn't get it to work. So, and Google also didn't help me. And after a while, I find out that that only a submit from Spark and forget works. So what you do is, on the second line, I put there the parameters what I'm using. It's just a deploy mode this cluster. And master is yarn, and that is the only way I get a Spark job running on my. And why is that? Normally, when you start a Spark job, it will also bring up a UI, and when you give it to a Hadoop cluster, it won't find its way back to the Docker container. So that is why it didn't work. But it took me some time before I found out. Then for a Kerberos cluster, we have a secure cluster, so you need to do a keytab file. Before you run your Spark job, you have to do a key I in it. what also helps on the left or on the down, the most of data scientists are using Python packages, and before we install them with pip install. But nowadays we are just using Conda for it. So with Conda we are building the virtual environment for the Python environment. So and what you get then is you have all your Python installation you have there, and at the end you zip it, and then in the I don't know if you can read it, but at the end in your Spark job you will send the zip file to the Hadoop cluster, and then it will run on the data nodes with the Python programs that you just installed in your Conda environment. Okay. Okay, let me tell you something about OpenShift, what we are using. For me, I don't care about if you use OpenShift of Docker Swarm. When I started this, I was using Docker Swarm, and yeah, for me that also works fine. But inside ING, we always try to use only one type of software. So, and there was already a department was running OpenShift, and nowadays Red Hat and IBM, it also the choice was is a lot of IBM stuff. So that is why we're using OpenShift, and in the end, it works the same almost as Docker Swarm, and even Docker Swarm also now also supports Kubernetes. So, there's one difference I have to tell about over OpenShift. Normally, you run pods inside OpenShift, and that is just a way to run your containers. But what you do with pods is most of the time you are running something like an Apache server or some other application, and that have to be 24 hours up and running, and that is why you can't use that for a data science model, because if you do that if you run a data science model in a pod, the data science model will stop running and he will start one again, because the container dies when the job is when the pod is finished, when the model is finished. Then he will start the container again, and then he will keep on running. So then you have another type, and that is called jobs. Later we'll show it. We almost ready to do the demo. But jobs you can use just to run once a container, and just when it's finished, then in OpenShift he get the status completed, and he will not run again. So that is very nice. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Let me demo you something. I hope the network is good, but let's pray so. Okay. Now this is the OpenShift console. Just via web UI. Here you see some deployments running. Inside the deployments, some pods are running also. But at the moment there is no no model running. But this is just only some pods what I use. And one of those pods that is the data science dashboard. I'm gonna show you that now. You can make a route to the deployment, and from there you can just click. I hope the network is a little bit helping. Yeah, we get some. Yeah, this is the monitor dashboard, and okay, let's see. Yeah, and yeah, this monitor dashboard that is used by the data scientists to look at how their project or how their model was performing. And I built here one as a demo project, and I can click on it. So, and then you see some graphs and some results of my model that I run. So now I'm not happy with the results of this as a data scientist, so I want to change this. So I want to run the model again. So what I could do now, I'm going to change something in my data science model and try to run that model and see what is happening all in OpenShift. Yeah. Okay. I can log on to my own desktop now. It's just a small Linux machine that is available at my company, what you can use to do all kind of stuff. Okay. Okay, let's make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so to change that, I'm not a data scientist, but I know a little bit about it. But I would just want to calculate the mean squared error, and I would just want to change something there on the number of iterations. And what I know, if I change something with the iteration, then the dashboard will react. So I'm gonna change something there. Gonna write it. Probably write what I did. Okay. So what I have here now is just an refresh command. And what it is doing is just will delete my old Docker image, and later on he will just rebuild an image, and then he will push it back. And after he did all this kind of stuff, then I will just bring a commit to GitLab, and the GitLab runner will start the container in OpenShift. I'm gonna kick this off. What you see now? He's deleting the stuff, and now he's sending the build command on the Docker file. He's reading those Docker file, and he's pulling in the image, and then he's building it. And he's already finished building, because I only changed a very small part in the container. Normally, just a Docker container is built out of images, of layers. So what you also have to know that if you change something in a layer, he will also refresh that, and you have to try to make it as small as possible. If you do something like Conda environment building and install all kind of Python programs, then that layer will be big, so it will take longer. So, so now he did something. I go back to. Log on to GitLab. Okay. Want to show you the pipeline. Okay, what you see now here is a very small pipeline. I've kind of it's a little bit slow here, but what you see now here, he give a command to OpenShift. Can also click on it. It's a little bit. But I gave a command to OpenShift to delete the pod what was running there, and at the end I just created. So if I go now to the OpenShift environment and I go look at the pods, then you see here that something is running. Oh, at the moment he is, some of my colleagues is also busy. So, but what you see now, the model is running. And that is just a Spark job that is just sent to the Hadoop cluster now. And he was just trying to talk to the Yarn, to the resource manager from the Hadoop cluster. And finally the resource manager say, okay, welcome, I see you have a Kerberos ticket, and I think you're allowed to do what you want, and let's start running. So, and all this kind of work, what he is doing now, what he's running, he's now almost doing nothing inside the container, because all the work is done on the Hadoop cluster now. So if we go now to the Hadoop cluster, to the resource manager, then you will see here that my model is running, and just give some number to it, and he's picking something from the yarn queue from the Hadoop cluster, and he's just doing his work there, and I think he will be soon finished. He's still running. Yeah, but what I created is just a test set of fake transaction data. It is some terabytes, so sometimes it takes 1 or 2 minutes before this is finishing. So it takes a while. But one thing you also should be aware of, that we only use OpenShift to run something outside OpenShift. So what you really have to know is there's no data at all inside OpenShift. You can do it, but just because all our data is on Hadoop and on HDFS, so everything is there, and so all the work is also done there. Let's go to the end. So yeah, what you see now here is finished. And if you look now, you see here that the model job is completed. So it's really a job, so he won't start it again. So he's really finished. So if I go now to my dashboard and I refresh it, see how long this takes. Okay. Yeah, you see that I was playing around, and the results are already there. So in fact, now what you have here as a data scientist, I was not even close to the data. I was only working on my laptop, in fact, and I have GitLab, and the only thing I did was a commit, and I managed as a data scientist to get this running without asking somebody from a department. I've heard this model, I want to run it on your cluster, can you do something for me, because this is all automatic. And if I'm happy now, I can say, okay, I run this in the first status of my environment. I run this now on my development, so I can say, okay, this is really good now, let's bring it to the next stage, and also put it to another Git repository, and then it also will run there, and finally when you want to run it in production, then the only thing you need is an approval somehow, because you cannot just commit in the production repository, but you only need approval from, okay, I want to change something in production, and this is my case, and I think I tested very good, and can I go ahead? Then somebody looks at it and he says just approve, and it will run. And what you see then is maybe in 30 minutes time, I can go from test to production, because all my images are everywhere the same, and nothing will fail there. The only thing what is different is the data. In production, you have the production data there, but for the rest, everything is the same, and that can really help you. Okay. Maybe I show you the Docker file that I used. It was very simple. This is just the Docker file I was running to build this image. So just I pull here the image, copy the model I was changing just, and at the end I just do an GitHub that I'm using. And then I do a Spark submit. Normally, a data science model will be much bigger. It will be just a lot of scripts. But this gives you a kind of example how it is done. Okay, let's go back to the sheet. Okay, there was the demo. Okay, some considerations. I don't have the answer yet on the top one. Use Jenkins instead of GitLab Runner. But What I saw is in Jenkins you can do more than in GitLab Runner. You can just build some software. You can use CBT or stuff like that, and that you cannot do in GitLab Runner. But yeah, if I look on the other side at GitLab Runner, it feels more convenient to use. So it is more it's more user friendly. So other question we still have is how we gonna do this with a schedule tool. Because what you get now is you get your commit and the model starts immediately running. So, and in fact, in production, you don't want that. What you want in production is, every third Friday of the month, I want to run this model. And for that, you need a schedule tool. So how I can do that with OpenShift? Because I can only give at the moment a signal to OpenShift, and he will start the model. So how does the schedule tool when the job is finished? So we still have to find it out, and for sure we're gonna find it out. But the last one is how to handle Kerberos files. That is an old remark for me, because I already find it out how that works. Because inside your Docker container, you don't want any store passwords, secrets, or whatever. And OpenShift have a way to store secrets, but that is just user ID passwords normally. But what I find out also is when you create a secret as a file, and normally a Kerberos ticket is binary. So when you use Base 64 to make a flat file of it, and you load that as a secret into OpenShift, then you can mount that to your container, and the moment it is mounted as a volume, he will automatically turn it back to a binary. So I even write a blog post about this, but that really can help you. Another thing is, but that is for later, I think, and there's already a department at my company using this. But sometimes you need more power in your OpenShift jobs than normally CPU, and I think that is for later. How can we put GPUs in the OpenShift nodes and put there not AC VEST data there, but start doing something with the S3 data or with Ceph. But for that you need something with the GPUs. Oh. Okay, it's time for questions. I think you have another screen for that. Yeah, has anybody a question for me? Feel free.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. It's Hadoop is old. Yeah. Of course, and the time is not standing still, but we also already are looking at S3 layers and that kind of stuff. But at the moment, we as a bank, we still use Hadoop and HDFS to store stuff. But there's for sure that is coming. Are your old data sizes different from any old dev pipeline? I see the same problems. What's the neat nuke for data scientists? No, don't under. Okay, the thing is with the old pipeline we have is with Docker you put everything in a container. And when you ship it, nothing changes. And what we have in the old pipeline, we were just picking up the project and change all the configuration files in that pipeline. So, and from there you pick it to the next stage, and you could do it again. And so sometimes you do it 4 or 5 times before you are in production, and it also takes a lot of time. So that is normally bringing up a container takes seconds, and that takes sometimes 30 minutes. So that's the difference. What extent is Arctic with real-time data analytics? At the moment we are working on an ACFS cluster, but the results from our cluster, what is coming out, is also going to an real-time data. So we export it and bring it there, and you also have other streams coming in there. And we also use technologies like Cassandra there. Yeah. Okay. Next one. How do you prepare test data? I allow to use test data for testing of production data for testing purpose. We have a prototype environment with a big firewall around it. It's only allowed to bring data inside of it, and there we can use also production data. So data scientists are doing their test there with production data. But the moment they are done with their testing and they want to bring their model into production, then you have some next stages, and there it will be no production data, but then it will be test data. Yeah. Okay. How do you refresh Kerberos tickets in Docker? In fact, the Kerberos ticket is not inside the Docker container; it is outside the Docker container. So what you do at the moment you have a new Docker Kerberos ticket, you have to bring it again to the OpenShift secret. So that is how we refresh it. So what you can do, maybe every day run a job that bring all the Kerberos tickets to the OpenShift environment. Okay. Now, more questions? How do you do data version? No. At the moment we don't do that yet. We just have one production data, and what you see is that you with time you can go back in time, but I don't think that you mean that that is the question, so I don't know. Okay. How user jobs are prioritized, limited on the Hadoop? We use the Yarn, the resource manager from the Hadoop environment, so the Yarn schedule will take care of that. So that is the answer. Okay. Next one. How to deal with cron jobs in Docker? I'm not a fan of cron jobs, so I'm not using it. Most of the time, what I was already talking about, I'm a fan of using scheduler tools, because what you see is, if you use cron jobs, it is only inside your environment, and nobody even knows about those cron jobs. So when something happens, you don't find out. So I like just that you have in your company you have one scheduled tool, and also people who are sitting monitoring your system at night, they also see that scheduled tool and can monitor it. So my advice, maybe you don't use it. Are you Docker cats Hadoop bin have to run Spark jobs? I explained that. It was just an submit and forget. Okay. I heard the word Cassandra. What is my experience? I just have a squad that is working with Cassandra. I don't really have experience with it, but I think for stuff like fast data, then Cassandra is your choice. I also have some experience with HBase, and if I can choose, then I rather go for Cassandra.
So we have 2 minutes left for live questions, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay. Well then, thank you, Leonard, for your presentation.
Okay, you're welcome.
And we have a gift for you.
Oh, wow. Okay, thank you.